I'm really pleased to be able to screen these films by Peter Hutton here at MOCA. Like so many people, I was really touched by his work. And some of the images that we'll see tonight are actually some ones that made me want to pick up a camera, or more specifically, made me think that some of the things that I wanted to do with cinema were possible. I guess I'm thinking specifically of images from New York Near Sleep for Saskia and Study of a River, some of which just struck me as pure poetry when I encountered them many years ago at this point. And Hutton created a cinema out of dreamlike yet concrete images that really all but alive editing just to focus on the power and the pleasure of being in the presence of the picture itself. But a screening like this takes a lot of people, so I wanted to just take a moment to thank Kate Brown, our great projectionist. Also, Alex Harrington, education assistant at MOCA, who does a lot of the behind-the-scenes work that makes a screening like this possible. And on the film forum side, similarly, Mary Culliver, who's our volunteer coordinator and does a lot of the things that film forum contributes to the series. Thanks, Mary. So in addition to screening these five films, we've invited some of Hutton's friends and colleagues to contribute reflections on his life and work. Before the films, we have James Benning and Steve Anker here with us in person. Then after the films, another Film Forum board member, Becca Keating, will come up and read statements that we had submitted to us by Ephraim Asili and Kelly Reichardt, who taught with Hutton at Bard College. I'd like to introduce Steve Anker. Steve Anker was the dean of the Film and Video School at CalArts from 2002 to 2014 and currently teaches there and co-curates the film screenings at Red Cat. And prior to that, he was the longtime director of the San Francisco Cinematheque, and so he's programmed and been quite familiar with Hutton and his work for many years and organized his own tribute to Hutton in San Francisco earlier this summer. So please join me in welcoming Steve Anker.
Madison. He's doing a remarkable job here, and it's quite creative curating, and to be able to do it in a museum that doesn't have a long history of art film, experimental film, is really to be commended. And as we've seen, those of you guys who've been here before, he's helped make this room, which is not that well suited for film, a nice place to watch films, as it'll be tonight. So I want to thank you for like me, but also just keeping this going. So, and LA Film Forum as well. So I'll just say a few things, and I want to read some quotes from Peter, because I think he was quite eloquent. I first saw his work and him in 1976, probably what was his first New York show, soon after he had relocated from the West Coast. I was pretty knocked out by the films, his early films obviously, just about 40 years ago. He was young and dashing and flaming red hair, thin, and didn't seem to have a lot to say because he was very quiet, even in the space of just an introduction and Q&A, but he was very eloquent nonetheless. Then a few years later, I got to know him in Boston, when the two of us were there together, and I remember him telling me one morning that he had just seen this shocking event the night before, which was like a major building in Boston burning down. He said, "Well, I had picked up my camera and I just shot it. I found a composition which I thought was really strong, and I made a film." But it was obviously something off the cuff, and we saw the film a week later, and it was amazing, because to me, it's a film called Boston Fire. Certainly it's one of his relatively smaller and more minor films, but it has really pretty much all of the qualities, I think, that made him a great filmmaker. For the most part, the camera is still, it's black and white, it's quite a classical composition. And yet he was able to, on the spur of the moment, come up with a composition that was able to frame the activities within it that watching the film later, she made it seem almost choreographed. And it was astonishing to me that he was able to do that. But then the values of the black and white and just the movement, again, this is something that was not planned or something he had a chance to see a number of times, which is what he was able to do in most of his later films. Anyway, so I then had another experience, it's a closer one, when I was in residence for a semester at Bard College in the late 90s. And he was a great teacher in addition to being a wonderful filmmaker. And I'm sure that some people here studied with him. And I think among other things, he was a great teacher because he really, he was interested in finding the voice and finding what motivated each student. And even if it was something that had to be worked through, almost like chiseling out, you know, the stone and finding plaster coming up with the form from it. And he was able to do that with students depending on where they were coming from. He was quite versatile, even though his own films were very rigorous, and over the course of a lifetime, concentrated and somewhat consistent, you know, he was able to speak to people making dramatic narrative documentaries, and he was a great teacher. But he was a great presence as well, and it was a shock and a sad loss for me, not only as a friend, but a relatively young filmmaker, and also Pete had been working for, he had been working for almost 50 years, 45 years. He started in the late 60s, and quietly, say, over the course of a lifetime, really had developed a significant body of work, very little of which has a chance to get shown, maybe more than once, which is pretty much the situation of what we call experimental film. You know, it's here today and gone. If you didn't happen to see it, well, maybe you'll see it again. And there he was. He had an amazing body of work. And I think what Madison has selected for tonight is a beautiful representation of one phase of that work. It's pretty much early films. It's in the United States, although it does move between, let's say, different aspects of his interests. So I thought I would just read some statements. One of the great things for me about what we call experimental film is that it is also very personal, you know, whether or not the work is evidently personal to the, you know, to the individual. You know, they're the results of a real personal inquiry and a, you know, sense of development and artistic voice. And I think anytime a filmmaker, you know, leaves us, you know, it's a gaping hole, and that's trying not to be cliched, I think it's true. And I think Peter Hutton, you know, he worked in a way that maybe had a relationship with the filmmakers who'd come before him, and certainly some contemporaries like James, who's going to speak in a few minutes, but he had a very distinctive way of looking and a focus in his work. He had been a painter and a sculptor, and those interests and those studies had completely informed his own work over the course of decades. So I'm going to just read a couple of things from Scott McDonald's interview that was conducted in 95 and then published in his book, First Cinema 3, in 1998. So I'll start by saying and reading, you know, there's a very simple idea behind what I do, which is to try to take people back in time rather than forward into the future. I reference a time when there hadn't been a sophisticated history of cinema. The Lumiere films are a revelation when you see them in this day and age because there's a certain kind of innocence to how they were structured. They weren't designed either to be narrative or documentary. The Lumieres were not intent on providing you with a bigger idea that results from the accumulation of images. Rather, they explored places without a lot of baggage. They responded to things as they came. That's precious to me. And then just another section from that interview with Scott McDonald. I've never felt that my films, are very important in terms of the history of cinema. They offer a little detour from such grand concepts. They appeal primarily to people who enjoy looking at nature or who enjoy having a moment to study something that's not fraught with information. The experience of my films is a little like daydreaming. It's about taking the time to just sit down and look at things, which I don't think is a very Western preoccupation. lot of experience, rather the a lot of influences on me when I was younger were more Eastern. They suggested a contemplative way of looking, whether at painting, sculpture, architecture, or just a landscape. But the more time you spend actually looking at things, the more they reveal themselves in ways you don't expect. For the most part, people don't allow themselves the time or the circumstances to get into a relationship with the world that provides freedom to actually look at things. There's always an overriding desire or mission behind a negotiation with life. I think when you have the occasion to step away from agendas, whether it's through circumstance or out of some kind of emotional necessity, then you're often struck by the incredible epiphanies of nature. These are often subtle things, right at the edge of most people's sensibilities. My films try to record and offer some of these experiences. One of the aspects of Peter's life and in his sensibility is that he had been a merchant marine. He did that for a number of years. In fact, that's how he paid for a lot of his education at the Art Institute in San Francisco. Actually, he moved from Hawaii, where he started started working on ships. And then when he moved to San Francisco, he went to school and got his BFA and his MFA there. And he studied with artists of all mediums, as they say, the painting, sculpture, film. But he would take a semester off, and then he would work, he would sail, and he'd come back and he'd go to school. And this is decades or years before container ships, so these were just a different industry, though. Like closer to what, the classic stories and the idea of going to sea used to be about. And I just thought I would read a couple of very beautiful, I think very moving and beautiful passages. And, you know, I say that, each filmmaker is distinctive, especially, the ones who really stay with it over time. And he did it over a lifetime, 16-millimeter filmmaker until the end. And, in a sense, as you'll hear, his experiences both fed his work and they didn't happen accidentally. He grew up in the Midwest, he grew up in Michigan, he was born in Michigan, but he found his way there and finally onto vessels, which really did a lot of forming of his sensibility. So these are just a couple of, I think, very telling and very beautiful memories he had. He said, one night, this one first. He says, one of the great revelations of traveling by sea is how slow it is compared to airplane or even train travel. You can actually go backwards in time on a ship. You can sail into a storm and make no headway and no geographic progress. You're actually going backwards as you go forward. One of the exhilarating and terrifying aspects of traveling by sea is the vulnerability you feel and the fact that you're not isolated from nature, but are rather in the heart of nature itself. Sea travel can be dangerous at times, and you confront that danger. Experientially, it can be overwhelming, and visually, it is incredibly rich. And then he says, one night I was out there, the moon was out, it was a summer night. It was warm, I was in a t-shirt. All of a sudden, I felt it getting really cold. I started scrunching up a little bit, and then I realized it was getting darker. The moon went behind some clouds. Colder, darker, and then colder and darker. It was amazing. I felt like we were sailing into an inkwell. I didn't realize there were so many degrees of darkness. Pretty soon you couldn't see anything. We were sailing into a storm, which I wasn't aware of. The clouds covered the moon, and everything closed in on the ship. It started raining. The seas became active. Then the officer on the bridge shined a light on me, which meant that I should go up to the bridge. I turned around, and a wave came over the bow. The seas were starting to boil. So I went to the bridge, and I continued to watch this rainstorm. We were sailing into the storm. It was so beautiful as a visual moment, something you could never film because it was so dark. It was this experience of sailing into this murky, dark world. Eventually, we punched through, and it started getting lighter, warmer. The sea started calming down, it started getting warmer, and I was, wow, what an experience. As an artistic moment, it was really interesting, spiritual. And this is, the scene where the ship must have been rocking. There's a kind of culture of survival when you're out at sea, where you have to develop a kind of visual acuity to know where you're going, what's happening. It's always been a part of the maritime culture, to be looking very carefully. One of the benefits, aside from all the traveling, is you're forced to look at things more carefully, particularly at night. You're out there in the darkness, you're thinking, there's nothing happening here. But night after night after night, you begin to see things that blow your mind. Pools of phosphorescent plankton under the sea that are exploding and illuminating. It was like hallucinating. Going through the Sulu Seas in the Philippines, it was like there were depth charges going off, and it was like exploding under the surface of the ocean. Porpoises would streak through these pockets of plankton like underwater rockets. Am I really seeing this? And those are quotes from an interview that appeared in the online magazine Cinemad, Mike Plant, and that's from 2009. The last thing I'll say is that the awareness and the ability to focus and concentrate is one thing, especially in this time, I think it's gotten more and more difficult to do. But I think to be able to translate it into film and in this classical way, which you see tonight, it's fixed image for the most part, fixed image, black and white, very spare, no sound, and yet a whole world, shot after shot that you can lose yourself in discovery. Anyway, so it was unique in my experience. I think that hopefully others of the films will show, because he made a lot of other films after these, decades until he died, and longer and longer films, and in some cases working with color too. So his work developed quite a lot. This is like a group of classic, wonderful, great films that I hardly show. So I hope you enjoy it, and thanks. That's it.
Things about being an artist is when you pass, when you die, you live on in your work. And I suppose one of the bad things about being an artist is when you pass and when you die, you're remembered from your work. And we tend to forget that these are people. For me, it's very difficult to speak because I relate to Peter as a person that I was very close with. And I remember certain things of sailing on the Hudson River in this little dinghy of a boat and looking at the water and spending many late afternoons sitting on the banks of the Hudson just watching the light change with Peter. And I always liked Peter because he called people honey, both men and women, and he generally said that when he was serious. He'd go, "No, no, no, honey. I didn't mean that. I meant this." And I would like to hear him call me honey when we're done. But we will live on in this work today. And these are an amazing group of films. And I think I'll let them speak for the rest of me. I'm getting a little teary-eyed here. Embarrassed, you know.
This is notes on Peter Hutton by Ephraim Asili. I met Peter during the summer of 2009. He was giving a talk at Bard College with James Benning, and I was a graduate student in the MFA program. Whenever I reflect on that day, I recall how inspiring it was to see the two of them communicated with a sense of self, knowledge, a knowledge that seemed related to their practices as filmmakers. The landscapes that they presented on the screen seemed to be a part of them. A part of them seemed to permeate the landscapes and the scene. They had internalized their filmmaking in a way that enabled them to be a part of the world in front of the camera. The distances between filmmaker, camera, and subject dissolved. The composition, form, and harmonics remained. At the time, I had given up the practice of creating my own original moving images. I had decided to separate myself from the use of a camera. I felt as though the world had enough original photography. I was spending most of my time sewing and sculpting. I had no prior experience with either practice. I didn't know it at the time, but I was looking for a way to enhance a sense of tactility into my practice. I left the presentation feeling transformed. By the end of the summer, I was ready to return to the creation of moving images. A few months later, I borrowed a Bolex and shot my first roll of film. Not long after that, I was off to Ethiopia to shoot my first 16mm film. About 2 years after my initial meeting with Peter, I had the opportunity to meet him again when I was applying for a job as the technical director at Bard College. Until that point, I had always lived in cities and was not excited about the idea of moving to the countryside. But the experience of meeting Peter the summer before convinced me that there was no other place I would rather be. I told Peter that his presentation had changed my life and that I had traveled to Ethiopia to shoot a film with the Bolex. That was the first time that I saw Peter smile in that sly sort of way that he did. His facial expression was not too revealing, but there was an internal warmth accompanying the smile that communicated volumes. Later, I was offered the job. From day one, Peter was there for me. He helped me sort out professional issues, ongoing family issues, and always encouraged me to keep on making new films and concentrate on my practice. Even if no one watches them or seems to care now, if you make a significant body of work, eventually they will have to accept it, he would always say. He taught me how to toss quarters during break time, diffuse the tension in situations with levity, and how to focus and keep grounded despite setbacks. When Peter was editing his final film, Three Landscapes, he allowed me to look over his shoulder as he worked. Armed with only two rewind cranks, a splicer, and a magnifying glass, Peter spent over a year meticulously cutting his work print. He would occasionally let me watch rough cuts with him. Sometimes he would ask my opinion. We rarely talked about film in abstract or theoretical ways. Ideas were communicated directly, metaphors used sparingly. We mostly talked about the ways of being present with an image, which images sustain the viewer, and which images are what he would call a snooze fest. Over the years, without much of a conscious effort, I began to internalize much of what I had learned from our informal screenings and discussions. I remember showing him a film that I had edited by hand one day. At the time, I did not like the film very much. The camera I'd used had some mechanical issues. He really wanted to take a look at it. He was so generous with his time. So generous. I agreed to project it for him. When the film was finished, he looked over and gave me that same smile that I recognized from years before, both sly and warm. That film later proved to be a major turning point in my practice, both artistically and professionally. Looking back at everything now, it was obvious that Peter had been mentoring me the entire time. Peter was such a great, subtle teacher that his guidance could go undetected at first, striking like a bolt of lightning later. Over the years, I would come to Peter's classes and cover them while he traveled or did not feel well, instruct his students on how to work with sound, and pick him up or drop him off from work when he had car issues. The last chance we had time to spend together was about a week after he was diagnosed. I went over to his house for tea. He was bright, energetic, and optimistic about his chance of recovery. He mentioned that he was a bit concerned about his work living on if anything were to happen to him. He said that when you get to be my age, it's important to be as much of an archivist as you are an artist. He seemed more concerned about grading his students, taking time to view their final projects, and being prepared for the fall semester. I had recently been hired to teach film courses at Bard after the five years of working as a technical director. I was overjoyed with the idea of working alongside Peter, told him so. He gave me a big hug, and we agreed to talk again a week or so later. The whole time we were meeting, he kept saying that he had some photos he'd wanted to show me, but could not remember which ones. When I got home that afternoon, he had emailed the photos. They were the last photographs of Muhammad Ali. That email was the last communication I had with Peter. I'm writing these notes as I sit next to Peter's office, and I can feel his presence even now. I feel truly honored and privileged to have been able to spend so much time with him over the last 7 years. I pray that his grace, beauty, kindness, and generosity live on through the rest of us. This is from Kelly Reichardt, and it was originally written for the Viennale. Peter Hutton died on June 25th of this year. This past week, in early September, I attempted to begin my first class of the semester at Bard College in the usual way, handing out the syllabus and going around the table with everyone introducing themselves. I was aware that most of the students had studied with Peter, or at least spent time with him. A few of the seniors were the sorts of students whose entire interest in film flowed through their relationship with Peter. Being under his wing meant you could find refuge from the all-inclusive spontaneity of the YouTube world and choose the less beaten path to a methodical, lifelong practice of shooting. An approach to filmmaking having less to do with big ideas and more to do with learning to train your eye. Filmmaking is a constant practice, so you learn to see more deeply the things that are in front of you every day, or go off and experience a place completely unfamiliar to you. So on Tuesday, all the Peterness hung heavy in the room, his absence so present. Perhaps we were all wondering the same thing. How does this work without him? I figured I should say something, but I couldn't think of what that would be. Maybe I could share what Peter said to me the last time I saw him, the week before he died. I was visiting him and his wife, Carolina, in their home in Tivoli. I was going to be heading back to Oregon. I was scared I might not see him again. I asked him what I could do from so far away. He squeezed my hand and said, "Just keep being yourself." That was such a generous thing to say in that moment, and what an awesome message to pass on to his students. Keep being yourself. But sitting there, I couldn't get the words out, and my glasses were fogging up. Finally, a young woman took the reins and began reading the syllabus out loud, getting us all back on track. And so this is how it will work now. We will each help each other through this. As Peter said when reporting on all the check-ins he was getting from his friends, the love train keeps rolling in. I recall once hanging out with him in his office when a girl came in crying over a bad grade. Peter was rolling a cigarette, and he kept looking down at the cigarette and let her tell the whole story about how the beauty was going to ruin her life. When she was done, Peter said, "Oh, who gives a shit? What did you shoot this week?" The girl went into talking about what she had shot, and Peter asked her questions about that, and the whole thing of the grade went by the wayside. I read where someone called him a purist. I always thought Peter was just a particular artist doing his particular thing. I can say that any time I was with him, I felt lucky, and I'm sure I won't meet anyone like him again. I never saw him frantic or rushed. His whole sense of time was so appealing. He was a proud father, a generous friend, and a super curious person, and a dog lover. He was also a kick in the pants. He once was throwing a stick to my dog and purposely tossed it into the sewer pond behind the phone building, laughing while insincerely calling her back. "Oh, come on, Lucy, honey, don't go in there." Then he left me with my wet, stinky dog. He liked to toss quarters with the students on the back wall of the film building between classes and had no problem relieving them of their laundry money and cigarettes. He drove a different borrowed car every semester. At one point, he was driving a van where you could see the road passing under your feet. Yeah, it's better to keep your feet up. I hope I never forget his voice. It's been hanging over my shoulder through the making of 4 films and through 10 years of teaching. I can hear him trying to keep me on track, trying to keep me honest, Just keep being yourself. Ahoy, Peter Hutton.